Welcome to St. Mary's Harefield streamed service for Sunday the 11th of September 2022, the 13th Sunday after Trinity. The death of Queen Elizabeth II has brought sadness to our nation and to our world. We will mark her life and her passing in this service. We begin with a prayer followed by an instrumental version of the national anthem played by the Coldstream Guards. So firstly, a prayer in response to the death of Queen Elizabeth II on the 8th of September 2022. Loving God, we give thanks for the long life of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, for her wisdom and dignity, for her faithfulness to her vows, her dedication to public service, for her Christian faith and joyful witness. As we mourn her passing, we bring you our own sorrow and grief. We hold before you this nation which she loved so dearly, and the wider Commonwealth so close to her heart. Especially at this time, we pray for her family, that you would strengthen and uphold each of them in their grief. We entrust Queen Elizabeth to your eternal love, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, was written and published by William Keith, a Scottish clergyman, in 1561. That's over 450 years ago. It was sung at the Queen's coronation on the 2nd of June 1953, at the instigation of the composer Ralph Vaughan Williams, who arranged a special setting for it, with trumpets and pageantry. It was an innovation by Vaughan Williams for this hymn to be sung by the whole congregation, not just the choir of Westminster Abbey, and the Queen herself was very much in favour of this. This hymn, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, is based on the words of Psalm 100. It's an invitation for everyone in the whole world to enter joyfully into God's presence, to discover that His faithfulness extends to every new generation. All people that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice. Let us pray. The Collect for the 13th Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, you search us and know us. May we rely on you in strength and rest on you in weakness, now and in all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We also pray, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to get hold of a piece of bread, we're going to be sharing that symbolically later in the service. The Old Testament reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8 and verse 11a, a time for everything. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. God has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The death of Queen Elizabeth II on last Thursday, hit us for six. This wasn't something we were expecting to happen when it did. And the shock and the suddenness of the announcement that the Queen had died stopped all of us in our tracks. We felt instinctively that this was a moment of massive change, of enormous historical significance, but we couldn't take it in straight away. We feel a deep sense of personal grief because the Queen has been such a lovely person and a figure of continuity. She was always there, and now all of a sudden she isn't. That sense of grief, personal and corporate, is the paramount atmosphere at the moment. We're still trying to come to terms with all that we've lost. In fact, many people feel that they've lost a member of their family in losing the Queen. So before we go any further, it might be helpful to ask how we deal with such grief, and grief in general. Indeed, can we ever really deal with it? It kind of deals with us. We can't suddenly switch off the knot in our stomach. We can't repress depression. If we try, it will only get bigger. Maybe we can't do anything, but it might be helpful to try to understand it in its wider context. It's been said that grief is really love. Our son Tom came across an interesting definition of grief that found its way into a WhatsApp group that some church members belong to. It says that grief is all that love we want to give, but we can't give. All of this unspent love gathers up in the corners of our eyes, the lump in our throat, and in that hollow part in our chest. Grief is love, which has nowhere to go. Her Majesty the Queen was greatly loved. She loved people, and it showed. She always had a bit of a twinkle in her eye. She seemed to get on really well with everyone, whether it be heads of state or down and outs. She seemed to get on well with James Bond and Paddington Bear as well. Grief is the price we pay for that kind of love. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 2. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die. Elizabeth, Alexandra, Mary's time to be born was the 21st of April 1926 at Bruton Street in London. Her father became King George VI in 1936 when she was 10 years old. Her father's sudden death from a coronary thrombosis on the 6th of February 1952 thrust her into the limelight as she immediately became queen at the age of 26. The fact that her father became king in the first place and that she then became queen was a bit of an accident of history. His elder brother, Edward VIII, famously abdicated to marry the divorced American Wallis Simpson. So Albert, as he was then called, became the third monarch of the House of Windsor, taking the name George VI. If the abdication hadn't happened, we wouldn't have had George VI, who guided this country through World War II, or his elder daughter Queen Elizabeth II, who remained on the throne for 7 decades as the longest-serving monarch ever. There's an expression in the Bible, tying in with Ecclesiastes chapter 3, which goes like this: "For such a time as this." It comes from the book of Esther, who was queen of Persia in the 5th century BC, and who saved the lives of many Jewish people through her courage. She was born for such a time as this. Could we say that Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II was born for such a time as this? In other words, that she was destined to be queen during an incredible time of change, with her character and personality geared to give stability during various periods of upheaval and uncertainty. We're also born into such a time as this. We're called to live at a particular time in history, right now. It's also true of the next generation. Rather than feeling sorry for young people today who face so much challenge, in fact, let's pray for them and empower them to embrace life in their own for such a time as this. The Queen's Christian faith was real, deep and personal. Her Christmas message in the millennium year 2000 included these words: "To many of us, our beliefs are of fundamental importance. For me, the teachings of Christ and my own personal accountability before God provide a framework in which I try to lead my life. I, like many of you, have drawn great comfort in difficult times from Christ's words and example. I believe that the Christian message, in the words of a familiar blessing, remains profoundly important to us all. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honour all people." The Old Testament records the year when King Uzziah died. He'd been on the throne of Judah for 52 years, a good king who was much loved. As many people mourned his passing, the prophet Isaiah had a vision of the Lord high and lifted up. This vision and experience was the calling of Isaiah to become a prophet, and a very significant one. At a different time of national grief and instability, Isaiah's vision of God being high above the things of earth, not fazed by the things that rock the human boat, established his faith and his ability to live it and communicate it. The Queen's personal faith in God, which she described in that Christmas broadcast, gave her the stability that she was able to experience and to extend to others, and the motivation to serve, to help, to bless others in their various needs, and to honour all people. There's a lot of other stuff in this passage from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, which we've heard read to us today. There is a time for everything. Yes, a time to die, as well as to be born. We saw that last week. A time to plant, to uproot, to kill and to heal, to tear down, to build, to weep and to laugh, to mourn and to dance, to scatter stones and to gather them, to embrace and to refrain from embracing, to search and to give up, to keep and to throw away, to tear and to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak. The passage ends like this: a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. God has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. It's all in the timing. We often don't choose the timing of things in life. We respond to them. We are presently in a time of war as we look towards Ukraine. We're in a time of mourning for our Queen, which will probably last longer than 10 days. We're in a time of great instability, and we have lost a person who seemed to be the most stable person around. The Queen had her horrible year when so much went wrong for her, her annus horribilis, when she admitted that 1992 is not a year on which I shall look back with undiluted pleasure. But she continued nevertheless with her determined dedication to serve and represent the people of Britain and the countries of the Commonwealth. One little thought before we leave the book of Ecclesiastes behind. These verses from chapter 3 seem to talk about life being circular, that various things happen and will keep happening again and again. When the Queen became Queen, the Korean War was going on. Now it's war in Ukraine. But it isn't as simple as this. The Abrahamic faiths, including Christianity, don't see life as being circular, as the Eastern religions do, but linear, with an end point in mind and progress towards this destination. Verse 11, God has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Life is cyclical rather than circular. Things do happen seasonally and repeatedly, but we do also make progress, and we can and should make a difference. The Queen made a massive difference over the course of her life. She had the ability to do the right thing at the right time, and she had an eternal perspective and destination. In so many ways, she has been Elizabeth the Great, and we will greatly miss her. The hymn, The Lord's My Shepherd, is a metrical version of Psalm 23, and first appeared in the Scottish metrical psalter of 1650. The tune Crimond is named after a place near Peterhead in Scotland. It was composed many years later, in 1871, by Jessie Irvine, the daughter of the Scottish Church minister of Peterhead Church, whose parish it was in. And we know that the Queen liked this hymn. It was one of the two hymns that she chose for her wedding to Prince Philip at Westminster Abbey on the 20th of November 1947. The other hymn they had in the wedding was Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven, which we also have later in this service. The Lord's My Shepherd reminds us that God can guide us through life's ups and downs by his goodness, his mercy, and his constant presence. The Queen followed the guidance of the God she believed in throughout her life. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. Today's Gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Luke. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. It's from Luke 22, verses 24 to 27, a different kind of greatness. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was considered to be the greatest. Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as the one who serves." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, dedicated herself to serve and represent the people of this country within the constitutional monarchy. She said, "I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to your service." In fact, she said this a few years before she would take the throne, in a statement that would ring true throughout her life. She lived a life of service, as advocated in the words of Jesus in Luke's Gospel, as he speaks to his disciples just after the Last Supper. Luke 22, 25 to 27, Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves." The Queen's serving nature of putting others first is seen in many ways in her life. In fact, in World War II, when she was Princess Elizabeth, she served in the military as a mechanic. She spent most of her time at the mechanical transport training section at Camberley in Surrey. The things she said are inspirational and illustrate her true character. She said, "When life seems hard, the courageous do not lie down and accept defeat. Instead, they are even more determined to struggle for a better future." Despite having quite understandable reasons to do so, the Queen never seemed to wobble in her determination to serve for one moment. She said, "It has always been easy to hate and destroy. To build and to cherish is much more difficult." The Queen has never judged, condemned, or put people down. Indeed, quite the opposite. She said, "It's worth remembering it is often the small steps, not the giant leaps, that bring about the most lasting change." Our Queen had much wisdom to impart to an age that so easily gets its priorities wrong. She said, "For Christians, as for all people of faith, reflection, meditation, and prayer help us to renew ourselves in God's love as we strive daily to become better people." The Queen always respected those of other faiths, but at the same time, she was very clear about her own Christian faith as something deep in her life. In the true spirit of interfaith, she was true to herself and open to others. She said, "I know of no singular formula for success, but over the years I have observed that some attributes of leadership are universal and are often about finding ways of encouraging people to combine their efforts, their talents, their insights, their enthusiasm, and their inspiration to work together." The Queen had the ability to unite people in action, to work together for the common good. For her Platinum Jubilee this year, she focused on planting trees for the environment and earned the title Green Queen. "To what greater inspiration," she says, "to what counsel can we turn than to the imperishable truth to be found in this treasure house, the Bible?" Her acts of service were inspired by what she found in the Bible. She could quite legitimately echo the words of Jesus and apply them to herself. "I am among you," she says, "as one who serves." The Queen's 1957 Christmas broadcast was an historic event. as it was the first to be televised. It was also the 25th anniversary of the first Christmas broadcast on the radio by her grandfather, George V. She bravely broadcasted live from the Long Library at Sandringham in Norfolk, and she included in this broadcast a couple of thoughts from John Bunyan. I would like to read you a few lines from Pilgrim's Progress, because I am sure we can say with Mr. Valiant for truth these words: "Though with great difficulty I am got hither, yet now I do not repent me of all the trouble I have been to arrive at where I am. My sword I give to him that shall succeed me in my pilgrimage, and my courage and skill to him that can get it. My marks and scars I carry with me, to be a witness for me that I have fought his battles, who now will be my rewarder." May God reward our gracious, servant-hearted Queen with the peace and blessing of eternal life. With regard to him that shall succeed me in my pilgrimage, we pray for King Charles, as he has a lot to live up to. The Queen would want us to give him the support that we gave to her. Long live the King. We have a book of condolence at St. Mary's Church, where people can write what they would like to say to the Queen or about the Queen. If you'd like to add a message, do either call into the church when it's open to do this, or let the office have your message and we'll put it in the book for you. What would I like to say to the Queen today? These words, I think, which come from Scripture, in fact, in the context of a parable Jesus told in Matthew chapter 25. "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of thy Lord." The hymn "I Vow to Thee, My Country" was written as a poem just before the First World War by a diplomat, Cecil Spring Rice. The poem was called "The Two Fatherlands" and describes how a Christian owes his or her loyalties to both their homeland and to God's heavenly kingdom. The hymn's popularity is helped by its tune, "Thaxted," written by Gustav Holst in his Planets Suite. Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II served the people of this nation, the Commonwealth and the world, with great dedication. She also served another country, where God is King and where his ways are ways of gentleness and all her paths are peace. "I vow to thee, my country, all earthly things above, and there's another country I've heard of long ago." As we come to the prayers, I'm going to light two candles today, one for the Queen, as we remember her, and the other one for Ukraine, as we don't forget its people. Let us pray. We pray for the royal family in their acute sadness at losing such a dear and unique person. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We continue to pray for Ukraine as it retakes territory occupied by Russia. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We continue to pray for the UK's new Prime Minister, Liz Truss, as she addresses so many difficult and challenging issues in her new office. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We pray for the continuing terrible situation caused by the flooding in Pakistan and for effective aid to reach those most in need. Lord, help us to serve others in all that we do. We pray for those who are ill. Especially we pray for Andrew Garner, Baby Alexandra, Barbara Leek, Beryl Harold, Brenda Davis, Candy Hamlow, Carlene, Eunice Haswell, Gareth Williams, Jill Pepperell, Gregory Ash, John Butler, Lewin, Mark, Neil Osgood, and any others we know. We also pray for all who grieve, for Queen Elizabeth II, for baby Henrietta Smith, and Joan Harris, and for Jill Davis, whose ashes are to be interred today. Let us confess our sins to God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The hymn Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven is based on Psalm 103. It was written by Henry Francis Light, and first published in 1834 as part of a collection of 300 hymns entitled Spirit of the Psalms. We know that the Queen liked this hymn. It was one of the two hymns she chose for her wedding to Prince Philip at Westminster Abbey in 1947. The other hymn which we had previously in this service, if you remember, was The Lord's My Shepherd. This hymn emphasises God's care and reliability, an important message for today's world, which seems so very fragile and unreliable. Tunes are very important for hymns, and the tune for this one, Lauda Anima, was written by John Gost in 1869. It's become one of the most widely sung Victorian hymns and tunes. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring. So as we come to this point in the service, we're going to share some bread together, if you would like to do that. If you have some bread, if you want to go and fetch it, I'm going to fetch mine now. We are united at the moment in grief, and we unite ourselves now too in a different way, in feeding off the bread of eternal life, and the bread that God gives us, the basic things of life that we need, the words of God, and so much to keep life going in these difficult days. So as we share this bread in our various locations, may God show that we are together, very much together at this time. We're going to hear a tune on the flute.
Thank you.
St. Mary's Church is open this week, and if you would like to come to call into it, drop into the church, you're very welcome to do so tomorrow, Monday from 10 till 2, Wednesday from 10 till 2, and Saturday from 10 till 1. It might be open other times too, we can't guarantee that, but we're trying to keep it open a bit more for people to come if they want to. You're welcome to come to find peace and quiet, and also if you'd like to light a candle in memory of the Queen, and if you'd like to write a comment in the Book of Condolence, giving thanks for the life of our Queen, you might want to do that. There is a midweek service as usual this Wednesday at 10 a.m. in the Church Hall Chapel. And next Sunday is Harvest Thanksgiving at St. Mary's, which we're very much still keeping as we give thanks for all the good things of life and the provision we have from God. So that's going to be 8 o'clock communion as usual, and 10:30 a special Harvest Thanksgiving service. There'll also be a Harvest service streamed as usual at 10:30. Any produce brought to church, by the way, and given, will be given to the homeless, which will be organised by New Hope Trust in Watford. Magazines for September are available. They're available from locations in the village, and if you would like to have a copy, let the office know and we can do that. Just to flag up too that the Harvest Supper is on Friday the 23rd, and do book in if you'd like to come. Just again, let the office know. That would be great if you can. The hymn, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, was written by Isaac Watts in 1708. It's based on Psalm 90, which contains these words. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Psalm 90 spells out the life expectation at time it was written. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. So the Queen, at 96, endured well beyond this biblical expectation. She's been a figure of stability over more than one generation. The hymn's tune is called St. Anne. It was written by William Croft, also in 1708, when he was organist of St. Anne's Church in Soho. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home.
I'm
We end our service as usual with a poem, and today we have a locally written poem by Sally Jane Tompkins, who's written this in remembrance of the Queen. 70 years, 3 generations follow on. Though we knew it would come, you are finally gone. A sovereign for decades, a familiar face, now you're in heaven and surrounded by his grace. Reunited with your loved ones, your strength and stay, the 8th of September, an unforgettable day. Now your legacy continues, your heavenly journey has begun. May you rest in peace forevermore, your service here is done. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today, this week, at this time of mourning, and always. Amen. The hymn, The Day Thou Gavest, Lord, Is Ended, was written by the Anglican minister John Ellerton in 1870. It's often sung to the tune of St. Clement, and its theme focuses on the worldwide fellowship of the Church and its continual global offering of prayer and praise to God. The hymn was selected to be sung as part of the celebrations for the Diamond Jubilee of Queen Victoria in 1897. It might remind us of the era that has come to an end with the passing of our dear Queen. The day thou gavest, Lord, is ended.